Hey guys, so today I wanted to talk about a topic that I talk about with clients very, very often, and I've had tons and tons and tons of my own personal experiences around feeling any type of lack, fear, scarcity, all around getting, keeping, losing clients, feeling like there's competition in your world, in your little bubble of people doing the same thing as you, and feeling all of this stuff around the client situation. And I've had my fair share of this, absolutely. I've had my own fears around, well, what if a client works with somebody else? Or what if they join somebody else's programs and I don't reach my financial goals? Or what if a client doesn't get the results, and how are they going to then feel about me, and how am I gonna have to deal with that? And these are lots of reasons why people don't even get started, because this is a lot of stuff that we have to take a look at. And as I've been doing my own personal growth and healing work to heal these places inside of myself that really have felt so tumultuous at times when it comes to this topic, I've come up with a list of 10 principles that I think will really support anyone who is working with clients, customers, or what have you, and they feel any of this stuff. So we're gonna go ahead and dive in. First principle is that client and audience relationships are always, at the end of the day, mirrors for our personal growth. They're going to show us where we might feel insecure. They're going to bring up all of this stuff. And that's actually, in the spiritual context, kind of what we're here to do. We're here to have relationships and grow and learn through them. That's not just our romantic partnerships, but it's our friendships, it's our family, it's our clients, and it's our audience. And it's really just another way to view, like, okay, where am I feeling discomfort? Where am I feeling attachment? Where am I feeling any of these things? And can I look at that and transform that and heal the parts of myself that don't feel worthy, valuable, feeling fear and lack and all of these things? The next one goes with this one, and it's really to look for the lesson within the trigger. Again, I've had so many experiences of this, getting into the business coaching space and having, you know, other people launching a similar program at the same time as me. Sometimes they were other people that I was perceiving were competition to me. And those were always moments where I was like, okay, what is that? Let me look into that. That is not necessarily true. I'm really just perceiving it that way. And what is it about me that's getting triggered? Because at the end of the day, it's really neutral, right? Everyone doing their own thing is really neutral, but we're in such close proximity when we're just staring at our phones, looking at our competition all the time, that we feel as though people are infiltrating our space and taking our clients, or any of those types of feelings that come up. It's really all an illusion at the end of the day. Next is that unclear expectations set with clients or unset with clients will poison the well of trust. So what does that mean? When we start working with clients, one of the fears is that we will lose them, or that they won't get results, or that someone will want a refund, any of these things, right? Like all these things come up when someone makes an investment, they pay you money, and they're taking steps towards doing the thing that is so scary for them to do. It's vulnerable, it's a challenge for them, they're really making a commitment to investing in themselves, and a lot of stuff comes up for people. And as the service provider, if we're not setting explicitly clear expectations around finances, when are people gonna get charged? How are they going to get charged? Around time, how often can you talk to me? How often will I respond back to you? When can you expect me to get back to you? When can you not expect me to get back to you? Where are the boundaries are in this relationship? Am I going to be giving you 24/7 access to me, or are we only talking at these times? And what I found is that people don't mind boundaries pretty much at all, so long as they're clear. And when they're unclear, you're almost setting yourself up for failure, or for an experience where you might have a tiff with the client or anything along those lines. And it's really just an unmet, unclear expectation. Attachment to outcome is ego-driven, and detachment from outcome is soul-driven. So what does that mean? When we get so attached to the outcomes of what we want to do and set for our goals, let's just say we want to get 20 people in our coaching program, and we get on the phone with somebody and we're feeling like we need them. We need them to sign up. We want them to sign up so badly. And then they don't, for whatever reason. Maybe they ghost on us. Maybe they can't do it because of the money. Maybe they sign up with somebody else. Any one of these things can leave us with this feeling of scarcity and lack. Like, I didn't get the thing that I so badly wanted, and I'm very attached to the outcome. Now, as humans, it's very, very challenging to be fully outcome detached, but these are things that we can work on and practice and cultivate a practice of looking at. The ego is the one that negatively compares, it judges. It's the one that has the voice in our head that's creating any kind of negativity or discord. It's the one that loves the drama and it gets hooked into the drama of who's doing what and this is happening and this person said this thing. That's really the ego. And it's trying to protect us. It's trying to keep us safe. So it wants us to have the easiest thing. And the soul knows, the soul, the authentic self knows that there's lessons in everything. That it can trust, that it doesn't need to have this client. It knows that maybe that's a lesson to get better at sales, to enhance my skills here, to grow and to develop into a person that is going towards the direction of their goals. And the soul trusts, the soul is the one that is centered. It's like that inner wisdom voice that we hear that knows these things. It knows that everything's gonna be fine. And the ego is the one that thinks that nothing's going to be fine. So the next one is goals versus intentions. And I love this one because setting goals, I've noticed for myself and my clients, setting these financial parameters around the goals that we want to hit for the year. I want to make this much money. I want to get this many clients. I want all of these things. And then I'm going to reverse engineer a process to reach them. That's usually not how it happens, right? There's usually lots of different lessons and barriers and bumps along the way where we're not actually every single time reaching the exact goal that we set. So what happens with goals is that they can be specific and numbers driven, which means that we might struggle to detach from the outcome of them. So it's like 20 clients in the program, I have a specific goal, maybe I hit 19. It's almost like you set yourself up for failure. And it doesn't happen every single time, but what it can do is give us a higher chance of holding it in a way that doesn't really serve us. Like we're holding it in our consciousness as, I need this outcome or else. And when we do it that way, we're not really connected to the intentionality of the result that we want to create, but we're also not really connected to how we want to show up, the lessons that we want to learn. And intention is a directionality of energy towards the thing that you truly want. And intentionality also has a quality of letting it go and trusting that it's going to come to you and releasing the when and the how. Whenever I hear people talk about manifestation, I just interviewed Gabby Bernstein. I have a couple other people on my podcast and a couple of friends that I just really love learning from around manifestation. And it really requires us to let go of when and how it's going to happen. So if we want 20 clients in the next 2 months, we might be too attached to the when and the how. Like I need to get them in this way at this time. And there's a lot of lessons to learn as we're going through this process. So just trusting that is really important. Trusting that the client is paying for a result, but they're always gonna leave with lessons. So this is not to say that we need to like let go of responsibility fully for how we show up with clients. It is our responsibility to do our absolute best with what we have. It's our responsibility to show up for the people that are paying us, but it's not our responsibility to get the result for them. And if they leave not getting the result, we need to have some discernment of how did this result not happen? And was it really a failure? Or are there a ton of lessons in here of how you can then go improve and do better? I've had plenty of business clients that didn't make their money back. But they learned exactly what they didn't want to do, what wasn't going to work for them, how to improve, where they need to improve, where there are holes in their either process or system or business model. And these things take time. And when people hire us for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, a year, whatever it actually is, a lot of these lessons take time. And failures aren't a bad thing. Perceived failures are lessons at the end of the day. So releasing over responsibility, not responsibility, but over responsibility for the client to just get a specific outcome that we set for them so we can feel good about ourselves is really not the way to go there. When it comes to getting clients, authenticity attracts soulmate clients more than any marketing strategy ever will. And I've seen this time and time again with myself when I show up as fully who I am and I take more ownership of the places within myself where I know I have right? I know I can do more video, or I know I could speak on a stage, or I know I can write this thing that feels really emotionally driven for me, and I can receive the positive or negative feedback, right? Like, the more we take ownership of the places inside of ourselves that are authentic to us, and we release and remove the barriers that we have to being our full self, the easier it is to attract the right people, right? So if we're trying to be like somebody else, if we're putting on a persona or a mask, we're either going to attract like the wrong people, or we're gonna be putting ourselves in boxes with other people, and that's where all this competition gets created, right? Like, oh, me and these five people all have the same exact program. There's lack, there's scarcity there. But when we're like, my energy is only mine, no one else has the same energy as me at all, there's actually no reason to worry about who's going to come into your programs and who isn't, because it's just gonna be more and more and more of really who you are, and those are gonna be the exact right people for you. And that's really where a lot of the trust comes in. Creating a safe space for hard conversations for your clients is a really powerful practice. If clients don't feel safe to talk about their financial concerns, to talk about maybe this doesn't feel correct for them, maybe they're having some ego stories around the timing and the overwhelm and all of these things that can come up when they're facing the fact that they are paying for someone to help them with something that they have not yet been able to do by themselves, it's going to be really powerful for the coach to create a safe space for them to share any of that stuff. And if there's not that safety, they're going to ghost on us, they're going to not feel comfortable talking to us about these things, and they might go on to work with somebody else. And either way, that's not a bad thing, it's just something to really be aware of. And if there's not that comfortability between you and the client, they won't talk to you about it. They'll feel shameful or guilty or anything along those lines. Trying to be everything to everyone stems more from fear than it does from authentic soul. So when, let's just say, a client wants to hire somebody else or work with somebody else, or they don't want to work with you anymore, any of these things, we feel like we have to solve all these problems and be their everything. We need to be their therapist, their fitness coach, their business coach. And when we aren't really fully embodied in everything that we're trying to offer them, the relationship can get messy. And a doctor can prescribe a client or a patient a correct diagnosis, and then they offer the right solution. And that might be outsourcing to a specialist. That might be going to see a nutritionist. That might be diet change. And when we can think of ourselves as that doctor, where we're looking at, okay, what do you have? What do you need? Who is the best fit for that? Maybe part of that's me, maybe part of it's this other person. Maybe it's going to be, actually, you know what? You might need to just do some stuff on your own before you hire a coach, because your needs aren't really there. And being able to discern that is super powerful. And finally, this one's really great, and it's one of my favorites, and that's why I put it last. Discerning between fear and ego in the client. And hint, you can only discern this if you know what it is within yourself first. So when a client is coming to you and they're feeling like they want to either quit, or they aren't responding, or they don't want to say yes to your program, there might be some business coaching out there that says, you know what, they're really scared, they need to sign up with you, and you need to be able to walk them through that. But the truth is, there could just be a moment where this is the lesson for the client that they're not really ready to learn. So authentically, if they're like, you know what, I really would love to do this, financially it's just not the right time for me, I am going to say no right now. We have to find acceptance in that. Or even if a client is really, really in their fear, if we're also in our fear around the fact that they're in their fear and they're not gonna sign up and say yes, neither people are in their authentic nature, and they're not grounded in their soul. They're living from fear, from their ego. When we can recognize the difference in ourselves, we can recognize the difference in our clients, and we can come more and more to accept where they're at and accept what's happening in this scenario. We can also learn how to support someone through a fear, ego-driven thought process or paradigm or belief system, right? But we can't put the responsibility on ourselves to be the person that pulls them out of it. So I hope that these were helpful. They've been really helpful to me, helpful to my clients, and I hope they're helpful to you as well. If you like this video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. If you're on YouTube, or comment below if you're on IGTV, and I will talk to you soon.